Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kelly, your host. Happy Tuesday to you. It's kind of feeling like a Monday, so thanks for being with us here on this Tuesday. Maybe it's Wednesday morning where you are, if you're on the other side of the dateline. We're going to do Ask a Priest this hour, both hours, as a matter of fact. You can call 888-318-7884. You got a theological question, you got a question about popes, about sacraments, about prayer, 888-318-7884. But Ask a Priest is a little wider than open forum in the sense that maybe you have a question about a family situation, a sacramental situation, all that, something that needs pastoral care. You can call and ask our priest. And who is our priest? Well, if we're having a good day, it's Father Hugh Barber. Hi, Father.
Hey, good day for me too.
888-318-7884. Thanks for being here, Father.
Happy to be here.
We're not shy about putting you to work. You're like in the building. We're like 2 hours of radio out of you today.
I'm happy to do
it. You're okay with that?
Yeah, talk. We can always talk.
Okay. Yeah, I can do that too. 888-318-7884. Father Hugh Barber is a Norbertine priest of the Abbey of St. Michael up in Orange County, former prior of the Abbey, and also our former chaplain. We were very, very, very blessed to have Father here with us for, I mean, time flies when you're having fun. So what was it, about 11 years you were here? Just kidding.
Two, I think it's two.
Was it? Yeah, that's good. 2 years. Man.
Seemed like 11, yeah.
No, I was only playing with you. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. And things are well at the Abbey?
They are.
That's good.
Going great guns.
Are you singing in the new? Yeah, you're singing in the new church.
Oh yeah,
right?
Everything's in the new church for everything, so it's beautiful.
But is there still building going on? Like, you still making some stuff?
Not at the moment. I mean, it's all pretty much. I mean, there's certain touches here and there, but we're using everything that can be used.
Yeah.
So the cemetery chapel's in use. The Abbey church and its crypt. The monastery itself, administration building, the convent, it's all
working.
It's all running, right? Thanks be to God. And our chant sounds like it should, because it has reverberation and whatnot. Yeah.
Oh man, that
and
must
you think
be
now
great,
this is
huh?
the way we sounded all these years when we were in that little church, but only the angels heard it that way. But now we can hear it.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
You told us at Mass today. You reminded us at Mass today about the billions of angels.
Billions of them, yes.
Who are
assisting at Holy Mass.
You said something really interesting, and while we're processing calls, I'll just ask you about this. You said that the majority of God's creation is invisible to us.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. If you consider, especially his rational, spiritual creation,
yeah,
it's invisible to us. You know, first of all, we can't perceive the soul or inner dispositions of another human being, even, although we can tell they're there. But with the angels, they exceed us in number.
Yeah.
And each one is completely different species, even though they're arranged in a order or hierarchy. But they're just the variety and the number. It's just going to be quite exciting to see them all in the kingdom of heaven. We'll see God face to face, but we'll also see just this amazing. I mean, if this world is already so amazing, or this visible universe is so full of marvels, what is the angelic world? And they accompany us at Holy Mass.
Again, 888-318-7884, the number, but they can't be studied by scientists. That's what you said today.
Yeah, that's the point. The majority of the universe cannot be subject to a demonstration by experimentation and repeated results that are the same. You know, so you can't have a trial to prove the existence of an angel. You have to do it a different way. And so they escape our human capacities except by our reflection. Yeah, it's amazing. And they're around. They're helping us, too, all the time.
Okay. Do they have a job in nature, though?
Oh,
like,
yes.
Like, like, for example, like, I don't know, like, in the just the functioning of the atomic world and whatnot, do angels play a role in that?
Right. We don't know specifically everything that they do or how they do it, but we know that the ministry or the governing of the material universe is committed to the angels. You know, they have a great role there to play. Yeah, definitely.
All right, we're ready to go to phones. You ready to go, Father? Luca in Lexington, Massachusetts is first up today, listening on the Station of the Cross. Luca, we're very happy to have you here with us. Go ahead and start us off for the week. Well, we did a show yesterday, but it wasn't live. So start us off with live calls for the week, Luca.
Great. It's great to be with you. So I had a question about like religious life and religious orders, mm-hmm. and I was wondering if Father Barber would be able to just sort of comment on the current state of like religious orders in the United States. And I'm interested in particular, like how like the level of orthodoxy that you see in some versus others, or if they're changing or yeah. their developments. I'm asking as someone who's interested in joining. So that's
why. Okay, Luca, are you from an Italian background?
Yes.
Yeah, that's from Pisa. Luca. No, from Pisa. There you go, Luca. It's a beautiful, beautiful form of the name. Although he's, yeah, that's marvelous. Luca, well, I'll tell you, I looked at religious congregations when I was a teenager and a university, and that was back in the 70s. And the situation was like this. There was the immediate post-conciliar period, and there was a lot of confusion and many, many defections or departures from religious life during those years, from the mid-60s through you know, 1980 or so. There was a lot of confusion and trouble, and it was very hard to point to particular religious communities that were unscathed by all of that. You know, all the great orders, the traditional ones that exist, they all suffered to some degree or another from that situation, because it affected the whole church, it affected religious life. But the reign of John Paul II led to a kind of slow but steady rebirth of sound religious life, where there was a clear grasp of the principles and there wasn't so much confusion. And those are both from new institutes and also from ancient ones that maintained the essentials of their life, because the Second Vatican Council asks us to, the religious orders, to return to the original charism of their founders. And of course, if you look at the founders of a religious institute and follow what the founders had in mind, you're always going to be Orthodox. You're always going to be observant of your vows. You know, everything that the church approved when it approved your particular institute is going to be in place. And so that's always a good way to go, is to look at what the initial original inspiration of St. Francis or St. Dominic or St. Ignatius Loyola, and in our case, of course, earlier, much earlier, St. Augustine and St. Norbert. That's the way to go. And then you look at the history of your order and see the fidelity to that charism or original gift throughout history, and to maintain all those things that supported it. I would say right now that the ancient religious orders, say the ones that existed since the Middle Ages, and then some of the more recent ones that are firmly established, like the Jesuits and others, all of them, even if they've had their difficulties or still have them, there's a significant portion in practically every institute where they really have held on or are holding on to the original charism of the founder. Although they may not have a universal unity of mind about that, it's still showing itself everywhere. For example, people can be very, very critical of the Jesuits, people who are on the traditional Orthodox side of things. And yet it's absolutely indisputable that in every Jesuit province there are significant numbers or personalities of people who are noted for their maintaining Orthodox principles. And that doesn't mean that the rest of them aren't, because you simply don't know, you know, because they're all individuals and they have a type of religious life which emphasizes individual initiative. But you can't generalize about a religious order and say, oh, the such and such fathers, you know, the daffodil fathers, well, they're all heretics.
They are, though.
You know, but they are probably. But I mean, and the you know, and the violet fathers, they're totally Orthodox because they used Teresa of Lisieux's favorite flower, which was not the rose, by the way, it was a violet. But anyway, but in any case, but the fact is that it's the renewal of religious life was willed by God for the church, and it is taking place in many, many different institutes. There's some which the profusion of vocations they have indicates that something good is going on. But of course, we have to judge really, if you're looking at religious life, it's your own vocation, the call which God is giving you to a particular community and a particular way of life in that community. And so you have to look at what is God's will for you. Because even if a congregation is completely famous for orthodoxy and observance and numerous vocations, there are examples, I won't name any names, but there are examples of large institutes that had all those marks that then had terrible crises because of behavior of some of their members. So you can't generalize and say, if I join community X, that's a done deal, everything's going to be great, because we're dealing with human beings. But we can say that God has me in the palm of his hand, And if he wants me to accept his invitation to the religious life, and Luca, he probably wants you to accept that invitation because he makes it in the Gospels to everybody. And so it's something every Catholic should take seriously. But you in particular, since you're asking me, I'll just say, take that invitation and find where it is you're supposed to answer it. And then you accept that charism that appeals to you, and then you persevere in it, come what may. Because God governs us by our free deliberation, and also in holy things, largely by our attraction. So what you happen to like or what you find attractive is one of the things that gives you an indication of where you ought to go. Is that helpful?
That's extremely helpful.
Yeah.
I've just been going back and forth in my mind, and that was extremely helpful. So thank you.
Great.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. God bless you. I'll pray for you, Luca. Okay.
Thank you, Luca. We got to take a quick break. It's Ask a Priest with Father Hugh Barber, both hours today on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
EWTN Global Catholic Network is the largest religious media network in the world. 11 global TV channels, English and Spanish radio networks with over 500 AM and FM radio affiliates, one of the largest Catholic websites in the world, dozens of podcasts every week, social media, electronic and print news services, and EWTN publishing. EWTN is the global Catholic network. For more about EWTN, visit EWTN.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Hey, we got a new thing. I just was reading about this here at shop.catholic.com. It's called Catholic Answers Rewards. And everything you do over there, you get points. Every time you shop at shop.catholic.com, you also get points if you do a review or refer a friend, or there's 10 different ways to get points at shop.catholic.com. And then you can use your points to get stuff. shop.catholic.com/rewards is where you can go find out about that. And
is
it says here...
Is that shop at Catholic.com?
Shop dot.
It's Catholic. Dot.
Shop.catholic.com. And I'm apparently not supposed to make a joke that you can take these rewards with you into the afterlife. So I won't make that joke. All right, Father?
Okay, yes. That's an ancient rhetorical trick. I like that. I will not mention. And then you go on.
Well, they don't want me to make the joke. Right. I won't make the joke.
Make it doubly funny.
Jordan in Woodbury, Minnesota, listening to EWTN on Channel 130 Sirius XM Satellite Radio. We're glad to have you, Jordan. Go ahead with your question for Father Hugh Barber.
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
Sure, Jordan.
My question is how to evangelize to friends and family who are agnostic, who say they believe in, you know, a higher power, a spirit of the universe, or a higher energy, whatever they may choose to call it, but are vehemently against any type of organized religion, and particularly Christianity and Catholicism, how to best kind of approach that conversation and maybe open up their minds and hearts to, you know, Jesus.
I'll give you something which was once given to me by a very holy Jesuit priest, actually a French Jesuit, very holy priest, Father Bertrand de Margerie was his name, and he was a famous scholar of the Fathers of the Church, and he's from a very eminent French family, and that was not all believing. You know, they were aristocratic French, but they were not all believers. But he entered the order and became a priest. He told me once, and I did this with a relative of mine who was very close to me, and it was a great consolation to me, and I'm sure to him, and it's this. Of course, what you're really concerned about with your agnostic family and friends is their eternal salvation. You want them to be united to God in this life and in the next. You want them to be finally happy, you know? And so you want them to be able to receive and to have what Jesus wants to give them. So think about doing something like this, to go to one or another of them, you could say just one at a time, or if in a small group, and offer, just say, would you be willing, on a set date or time, just to sit down with me and just hear me tell you what I believe? Just, and then you just sum it up. If they give you 5 minutes, do it in 5 minutes. If they give you 10, do get 10. If they give you 30, do 30. But not much more than that. But just, you know, what you believe, especially in terms of what God offers to those who accept Him in Jesus Christ and in the sacraments of the Christian life that our Lord offers, in the life of grace and the hope of heaven that we have, and just go over what we actually believe. It's not asking them to, they don't have to comment. In fact, that without comment, just saying, I'm not going to try to convince you or argue with you, but if you could just hear me out and with no strings attached, just that, nothing else, so that I can do this for you, and it would be good for me because I'd feel like I'd been able to fulfill my duty towards you of just letting you know what I believe, and then you can take it or leave it. And if you want more information, you can, but just let me tell you about it. And it's amazing how many people will say, well, okay, especially if it's one at a time, especially when they know that they're not expected to respond and that you're not looking for a discussion or a session in which you try to convince them, but you just tell them what you believe. Simply, you know, just, it's basically like, you know, preach Christ and Him crucified. You know, just tell them what you believe, even if it sounds crazy to someone that doesn't accept our faith.
Yeah.
You know, that God became a man for our sake and you know, all the basic truths of our religion. Does that make sense? Could you do that?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, basically you want to evangelize them, but just make it user-friendly. Make it not threatening or contentious. To say, I really would just like to share this with you because it means so much to me. I just want to tell you about it. And that'll be it. I will not revisit it. I won't be wanting to do this again next week or next month or whatever. And then you prayerfully, you know, pray beforehand, you know, make a novena or pray and have prepared what you have to say, but just try to say this in the most natural and loving way you can. And then just trust that God will use that because they might remember those teachings that you give them at a moment when they really need it, even if it's just a moment of their death, you know, the motivations for faith in God, you know.
What do you think, Jordan?
Yeah, I think that's really helpful. It can be challenging to, you know, approach people that you love and you care about, and you don't want to, I don't know, you want to spread the word, you want to carry the message, but then you don't want to overdo it. You don't want to overstep
right.
your bounds and turn them off even more. So I do think this is some pretty practical advice on how to kind of go about it. Because it's something that's been on my mind for a long time, and I don't really know how to go about it.
Well, it's one way to do it. And you can also tell them, if you say no, that's fine. I'm not going to keep nagging about it.
Yeah,
but you'll have put that in your mind that you're willing to do that for them, and they might come back to you and say, "Well, actually, I would like to hear," you know, that people can change their mind. This happens, but this priest asked his very snooty, aristocratic French family members to listen to him for 5 or 10 minutes explaining the Catholic faith, and it got beautiful results, kind of at the last minute, but it did, you know.
Wow.
And in my case, when I did it, it also had beautiful last minute results as well. So,
thanks, Jordan, for that question.
Thanks, sir.
God bless you. I'll pray for you and your family, for Jordan. Okay?
Thank you.
Sure. Peace.
Our number is 888-318-7884. It's Ask a Priest today on Catholic Answers Live. Our guest is Father Hugh Barber, Norbertine priest. And up next is Eduardo in Florida watching on YouTube. I think we spoke to Eduardo recently. Hang on. Eduardo, did we just have a conversation a short time ago?
Yes. Hello. How are you?
Hello.
Actually, I have this very same question. but apparently we were going into a break or the end of the program, so that kind of the back and forth.
All right, I don't want to do that to you again, and there's going to be a break coming up, so just give it to him real quick.
I remember your question. So you work at Hard Rock Cafe, right? And it's a place that where there's a lot of...
I'm about to start that new job.
Okay.
And basically my concern is, like, it is a company, it has this hotel, and I don't think, you know, couples go there, married, you know. I think that's kind of a place where you can suspect there is going to be sin.
Sure,
and if that will be okay for me to work there.
Okay, you know? Thank you.
The thing there is that it's the broad thing is that it's what in Catholic moral theology is called material cooperation. That is, you know, we constantly, all through our lives, we are materially helping people to commit sins, but not actually or formally helping them. That is, you know, if you feed a couple who are committing adultery, if you give them dinner, you know, you're supporting their relationship by feeding them, but you're not in, that's not why you're doing what you're doing. You're doing it because human beings have to eat dinner, and you are someone who does that. And the position of someone who waits in a restaurant or even runs a restaurant is not to correct or judge or direct morally the people that come in, because they're coming in for dinner. They're not coming in for spiritual direction or instruction. And it, only if the people were asking you to cooperate directly and formally in their sin, to facilitate it in some way that's directly related to it, like, say, the guys, that like you'd see in Europe, the guy's eating dinner with this woman, and he grabs you aside and says, "Hey, do you know if I could, is there a condom dispenser in the bathroom here? You know, could you help me with that?" You know, there you're cooperating, and you can say, "No." You know,
I can't help you.
I can't do that. But if it's dinner, you know, even a sinner has the right to dinner. You know.
Yeah.
So
there's a bumper sticker.
Right. Exactly.
Even a sinner has a right to dinner. Right. I'm gonna get those bumper stickers made.
Right. So and you need work, which is also your right to have gainful employment, and so. You know, people are sinning all the time for all kinds of things, but you know, if you work in a gas station where they still fill the tanks, like in New Jersey or Oregon or someplace, then, you know, you could be filling the tank for someone who's just about ready to go commit a crime, but you're not participating in that crime. You're just filling their car. And so take it that you're doing legitimate work, you're serving people, and by your patience and good cheer and good example to also your coworkers, you can bring a little light into that pick-up-y kind of, you know, naughty environment that you would find in a nightclub like that. I mean, that's just the way it is. When I was 18, or no, I was underage. If I admit it, this is years and years ago, but I was taken to a Hard Rock Cafe, but I didn't misbehave, but I was there. So, and I think I managed to overcome the thing. So I would just say, do your work lovingly and carefully for the people that you are taking care of there, and trust that our Lord will use you as a Christian man to do good things.
Eduardo, thank you. I do hope that was helpful to you. I remember when I was 18, that wasn't underage. In Massachusetts, that was not underage. And then they changed it afterwards.
I may not have been underage, too. It may have been before that went to 21.
I think everywhere it's 21
now. In fact, it was, when I was 18, it wasn't underage because that came in under Reagan, 21 drinking level. Yeah, because they wanted to stop all kinds of problems. Yeah.
That clearly cleared everything up.
Yeah, it certainly did.
Everything's better now. 888-318-7884, our number. We'll go to James. Thanks, Eduardo. We'll go to James in right here in California, listening on Catholic.com. James, thanks for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Yes, my question is this. I have a Protestant friend, and about a year ago, and because of the COVID situation, we haven't seen each other, but we're going to see each other again this Friday. And he gave me an article, a picture of Pope John Paul II in 1998, he had visited Cuba.
Right.
And apparently the photo shows him putting a crown and draping a rosary and what's called the Our Lady of Charity, or in Spanish, I guess it's called
Caridad,
La Señora del Caridad en Cobra Esti. So here's my question. He gives this to me, and apparently, you know, he caught me off guard. He says, "See, change." He goes, "You Catholics, the Pope, look what he's doing. He's worshiping idols." So I said, "Well, let me look at this." So I did some reading, and here's the clincher, what he told me. He goes, and I read this portion. Apparently, when he did that, many of the Cubans celebrated because apparently she's tied to Santeria, which is a really bad pagan religion.
Right.
So my question is this: how do I respond to him? I'm thinking of the word syncretism. I was going to tell him, well, look at the Cubans took something good and mixed it up with paganism. But can you give me resources?
Sure.
I'll tell you what's going to happen, though, is I'm going to let Father start answering you, but you're going to have to hang through the break because there's no way he's going to get a full answer out before the break comes. Can you do that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Go ahead, Father.
Well, of course, Our Lady of Charity of Cobra is the patroness of Cuba. And it's like typical, there are a lot of different titles of Our Lady under which she's venerated in certain countries, and in Cuba it's that. And there's a story behind the image and all that with the little boat and all, but I don't remember what the story is, but there is a story behind it. But then it's very easy to explain the issue of Santeria, and we'll get to that after the break.
James needs some help talking with his Protestant
Jaime
friend.
Jaime will be back.
About
Santiago,
the Virgin Mary.
Whatever.
Santiago.
Peace.
All right, right back after this.
Stay on.
Ask a Priest, Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic Answers is doing it again. We're holding our 7th annual Apologetics Conference this September in beautiful San Diego, California, and we'd like to see you there. Join us September 23rd to 26th for a lively and inspiring conference with an all-star lineup of speakers guaranteed to jumpstart your faith. It's a great chance to meet all your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and very special guests as we spend 4 days talking about worshiping and adoring our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is where it all begins. Don't miss what promises to be the event of the season. Join us this September for a conference that is sure to ignite, inspire, and inform your faith. Seats are still available, but they're going fast. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 888-291-8000 to register.
Hi, this is Johnette Williams. We embrace the essence of feminine spirituality on Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. James, with a question for Father about Our Lady of Charity in Cuba. So James has a Protestant friend
who believes that
Pope John Paul made public worship of Our Lady, and by doing that, encouraged the religion of Santeria in Cuba. How does he respond to that?
Okay, well, the Santeria religion, that actually uses Catholic images, Catholic icons, images of Our Lady, of the saints, and even of Our Lord, as a covering for the veneration of non-Christian divinities. And so it actually is proof that the people were being taught not to venerate the non-Christian divinities, and in order to hide the fact that they were, they simply used the Christian saint as the cover for another one.
I see.
And that's what's going on there. But the vast majority of Cubans, they venerate Our Lady of Charity as the mother of Jesus and the one who prays for us in heaven and who is filled with charity, you know, that she's the mother of fair love, as we call her in Catholic liturgy. So that's not a that's not an argument against our veneration of Our Lady, because people can also misuse even the Savior himself, you know, can be misused or misinterpreted. I mean, he's venerated by the Mormons as the brother of Lucifer, and yet that doesn't mean that veneration of Jesus is the veneration of the brother of Lucifer.
And we're not encouraging that when we venerate Jesus.
Yeah. It's just people can have all kinds of crazy ideas and use all kinds of words and names and images and whatnot that are not what we teach. And then as far as worship goes, well, of course, the veneration we give to Our Lady is a reasonable one. And it's just the same as, you know, when you frame your mother's picture, you put a nice gold frame by your mother's picture. Are you worshiping her as a goddess? No, but you're honoring her image. Or you kiss her image because you miss her or something like that, that's not worshiping a god. That's worshiping a human being whom you venerate very much. And, of course, the Mother of Jesus we love with a special love. And so we show it in the images we make of her and in the veneration we show them, just as we do with other human beings. We are no longer under the Mosaic prohibition of making images for veneration because God has become man. He's become one of us, and we are allowed to represent him in paint or in carving and also venerate those images, because we venerate not the wood, not the stone, not the work of our own hands, but we venerate the person the image represents. Just like, I mean, it always amazes me, you know, none of these people object to ceremonies regarding the flag, that it has to be folded a certain way and held a certain way and treated with great reverence, and you dispose of it not by throwing it away but by burning it. It's treated as a sacred object, and yet none of these Protestants in our country accuse American custom of idolatry just because we're treating the flag. I mean, if you ever watch a retiring of the flag ceremony.
Yeah, it's very religious.
You know, if it were a Catholic something, they'd all be going, oh, what are you doing? It's superstition.
Yeah.
No, but we recognize the flag represents our nation, our founders, our principles, the people that died for it, and so we treat the flag with respect, because it's an image of the nation. The same thing goes with the images of Our Lady. So the syncretism thing is a problem in many countries that have the survival of certain ancient traditions, or it's been mixed up with witchcraft and whatnot. But that is not the Catholic religion, and the Church has always fought it or tried to teach people to avoid that sort of thing and to stick with the faith of the creed and of the Bible.
James, what do you think?
I think that's excellent. Thank you. It makes it very simple. So in my simple mind, it would be like if you borrowed my car and you went and robbed the bank. I mean, you use it for the wrong purpose. It wasn't my fault.
Exactly.
Right. Well done, James.
Right. Exactly. That's a very good. That's a good. Good. That's an even better example, because it shows that you take something good from somebody and you use it for something evil. And that's what the misuse of Christian icons is. And you see that a lot. You know, you see rock stars, you know, who were openly promoting immorality, you know, with giant crucifixes on and throwing rosaries around. And then I have to say, well, at least they've got a crucifix on. Maybe they'll think about it, you know.
Maybe it'll occur to them.
But I mean, the point is, yeah, that's, you're exactly right. That's good. God
James,
bless you.
Thanks. Thanks very much. Man, we have so many people on the line. I'm going to keep moving. It's Ask a Priest with Father Hugh Barber this hour and next on Catholic Answers Live. Now we go to Rhode Island. Giovanni, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Giovanni, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Hello, Father.
Hello.
My question has to deal with, is about religious liberty, right? Essentially, my question is this. What is the Church's position on religious liberty? Because some Catholics, right, say that religious liberty is a bad thing. Like, it's modernity, it's the spirit of Vatican II, it's essentially a bad thing. And they usually make this distinction between religious tolerance, which could be beneficial, and religious liberty, which is, like, you know, modernist and bad and all that. So I want to know from a priest, what is the actual position?
Sure. Okay. That's a very important question, and it has a lot to do with the concerns of very many faithful Catholics in our own time. It's nice you're calling from Rhode Island, which, of course, is the place where it's a state founded by Protestants fleeing persecution by other Protestants. so you know, that's one story. Well, first of all, it's important to remember that religious liberty is not a natural principle that has been found in European or even American history always from the beginning. You know, at the time when our country was founded, the different colonies, they all had some degree of established religion and limitations on religious practice. So it's not unusual in European culture, Christian culture, to find this. And so that's just one historical fact, you know. But then what the Church actually teaches on religious liberty is somewhere between what you describe as like mere toleration of error and the sort of modernist indifferentism, we would call it. That is, what the church always taught was that no one can be constrained or forced against his will to profess the faith. Okay? So no one can be forced to be a Catholic, and no one can be forced to act against his own conscience. Even an erroneous conscience has to be obeyed, because subjectively the person that's in error believes that he must do what he's doing, and as long as his erroneous belief doesn't lead him to do something which is immediately and urgently contrary to the common good of the society, then he should be given the freedom to do what he finds best. Now, in religious matters, it's a very delicate thing, because we're talking about the form of the human conscience at the deepest level. A person's religious commitments are the most profound and the most important of his life. And so just as people are free to marry whom they will, I mean, in the moral law, at least someone of the opposite sex who's, you know, also free to marry, and that's a deep commitment as well. In matters that regard our relationship with God, the freedom of the individual soul has to be respected in a way which is preeminent. And so what is offered to the soul by society in the church teaching now, it's made more clear, is not mere toleration of the freedom of the soul to choose or deliberate, but rather a positive admission that the person should be free, in fact, to consider these matters and to act according to his conscience. Now, what we believe as Catholics is, if someone has an erroneous religious belief but is truly open and sincere and wanting to discover the truth, that God will bless that and lead them in the right path, and that they have the hope of salvation, because they are not posing an obstacle to God's work in their soul. But that's something we can't peer into. Now, on the other side, we have to say that obviously there is a preeminent benefit to society if all of the members of a society were to profess the Catholic faith. That's a benefit in and of itself. And if you find a society where the Catholic faith is predominant or preeminent, it is not wrong for the state to recognize or give or recognize certain rights of the church in terms of education and marriage and other such things, and to favor the profession of the Catholic religion, and to try to limit the evil results of people trying to undermine the faith of the church, because it becomes part of the actual identity of the people. But that still has to be within the limits of respect for the conscience of individuals, so that even, say, in the most traditional Catholic regime, say, for example, in Spain, before the mid-1970s, where, you know, the only Protestant churches were in embassies.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they were publicly open. Or if they were publicly open, they couldn't have, you know, obvious signs and advertisements and whatnot. They had limitations on that. Still, it was not illegal for someone to go to worship in those places or to investigate the Catholic faith or the religion, these other religions. And the church would still teach that you're not allowed to constrain the conscience of anyone. But on the other hand, the emphasis back then was on, we accept non-Catholic profession of non-Catholic religions because their toleration is better for society as a whole. Now we would say, whereas that was not untrue, that point of view was not at all untrue, still there's a more positive way to put it, and that is that the form of the human conscience needs to have such respect that people can freely investigate religion, and that means investigating our claims against the claims of another religion, and that means that has to be accessible to you in some way. And so religious liberty is a positive value in that sense, although it doesn't mean that the state has to be completely indifferent to religion, or even, as we find nowadays, combat religion as a menace to freedom. You know, the founding fathers of our nation regarded the practice of Christian religion and indeed even the Jewish religion as a good thing in itself for society. and they would have opposed any notion of an America which was completely secular and without religious practice. And so they were in favor of the government favoring the practice of religion in general, but they were against establishing on a national level any particular religion. And that matched the nature of the people. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to govern them, you know,
right.
Because there's a mixed group. But that's very different from the condition of a country where everyone has the same religion. And where the common good may require very careful consideration of that. In the evangelization of the pagans, you know, during the missionary period, how respectful were the missionaries, not always the conquerors, but the missionaries, to that reality? Like in Mexico, Cortez troops, they would knock down idols, and the Augustinian friars with them said, no, you leave the idol up, and we'll give them a crucifix, an image of Our Lady, and tell them to pray in front of it, and when we get back, they will experience the difference between the two cults. Now, that's a very Catholic way of doing it, but the two forms of worship, that's what cult means. And choose. That is, they had a certain respect for the fact that this was their culture and that it wasn't simply to be abolished. On the other hand, there's saints who were a lot more, you know, assertive in overcoming paganism. But in any case, it's a settled question now. The church does not ask for exclusive recognition by the state. That's a judgment of prudence, but it also is a judgment of prudence which could be prudently evaluated in some other way in other circumstances, but it's based upon a real fact which is not merely prudence but is a question of the natural law, that is the inner freedom of the human conscience to embrace the truth for his salvation.
Yeah. Giovanni, I got to leave it there. I hope that was helpful to you. Thank you so much for that question, but we got to take a break. We'll be right back with more Ask a Priest with Father Hugh Barber on Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
I'm Roy Brown, Executive Director for Billings Catholic Radio. Catholic radio is arguably the greatest tool for evangelization. Radio has the power to speak directly to individuals and creates a sense of one-on-one fellowship. There is no better way to evangelize than through a relationship where we can share and bring the love and joy of Christ to another's daily life.
The world needs EWTN Catholic Radio, now more than ever.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Father Hugh Barber is our guest. Lines have stayed very, very full, but there's one line open right now for Ask a Priest, 888-318-7884. We're going to continue into the second hour. So if we don't get to you this hour, just hang on. We'll get to you the second hour. And for just for a moment here, we welcome Erica, the events coordinator here at Catholic Answers, into the studio.
Hi,
Erica. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm really, really good. I'm not feeling like a winner as far as my guess about how many people would be coming to our conference.
You know, I think you came closer than anybody else.
Really? Because I said 1,000 people.
You did, but I said 300. and we like far surpassed that. We're almost to 700 people.
Oh, I didn't know we were that far along.
Yeah. Can you believe that?
That's great.
I did not think we'd get there. I thought we'd get maybe 300 to 400 people. And I think everybody's just inching to get out of their house and come and have a good time with us.
Well, plus it's an awesome conference.
It really
put
is.
Together. Really amazing. I mean, all of our guys are going to be there, including Joe Heschmeyer.
Yeah, Joe Heschmeyer is going to be there. I'm really excited. I've never heard a talk by him yet, and so I'm really excited about him. But we also have a really good lineup of guest speakers.
Bishop Joseph Strickland.
Yeah, Paul Gondreau.
Sister Maristella. Yeah, who was on the air with us just the other day.
Yeah.
Paul Cech.
Yeah, Father Paul Cech will be giving two talks during the lunch hours.
Are you going to come by the conference? Or can't,
I'll probably
can't
show my face at some point.
Oh, you
yeah.
will? Okay, good.
We surprise!
Like oh, was I not supposed to say
no,
that?
No, it's good. Okay. It's good. Yeah, I would love to have Father Hugh come visit us at the conference.
Bishop Strickland will be given the keynote address. And when's the last day you can buy a ticket?
So here's two big announcements that I have to give you guys. So today, you guys, is the last day to get a hotel room at the discounted rate. So if you are coming and you have not gotten your room,
get it today.
Call or go on our website. There's a link straight on our website. And get your room today, because today's the last day for the discount. If you are thinking about coming to the conference, you might want to get your ticket today because you need to get your hotel room. But the last day for full conference tickets is this Friday.
Oh.
So on Friday, if you want to come to the full conference, which includes the banquet dinner, which Bishop Strickland will be speaking at,
right,
you need to get your tickets by Friday. I will close full conference on Friday.
And then you could get just talks after
that. You could just get talks only after that. Talks only tickets will be selling up through the conference. Okay. So that's no problem at all. But if you want to come to the dinner and listen to Bishop Strickland's keynote, you need to get your tickets by Friday.
CatholicAnswersConference.com is the place to go to find out all about it. It's September 23rd through 26th, which is amazing. It's just like, what is
that? That's less than 3 weeks away, right? It's around the corner. It's like 2 weeks away. I'm in like give Erica chocolate mode. Like,
oh, I'll give you chocolate. All right.
If you see me, give me some chocolate.
This is one of my favorite things about Erica, though.
The 2 weeks leading to the conference are like the give Erica chocolate week.
But everywhere that I've ever been, the events coordinator is a miserable person leading up to the event. And you are not. You are always delightful to everyone.
Thank you.
It's like you have the gospel in your heart or something.
Aww,
I hope so.
Sweet.
CatholicAnswersConference.com, and we're going to do the radio show there twice.
Yes, Thursday and Friday.
Thursday and Friday, we'll do the radio show.
Yeah.
And maybe we'll see Father Hugh Barber's face. Bring the rest of you, too. Anything else you want to say, Erica?
I think those were my two major announcements. So get your tickets by Friday. It's
Where?
Going to be a great time. Go to CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Erica!
Yay!
Father Hugh Barber, our guest. Back to the phones we go. Oh, we're going right here to California. Rancho Cucamonga, California. Listening on Catholic.com. Ida! Ida, you there with us?
Hi. I'm here.
Hi, Ida.
Hello, Ida.
Thank you for taking my call. Hi, thank you. Well, I'm very concerned with just everything that's going on in the church right now, but I'm particularly concerned with a family member who's very devout but is experiencing a great deal of stress and anxiety over, like, believes that the Freemasons have infiltrated the church and have practically taken over, including the Pope, bishops. And so I just want to know, like, maybe if we have resources or how I can help this person, because I mean, she's constantly, sharing things on family threads, and I don't know. I just need maybe
need some help with that. All right, okay, Ida.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Father.
Thanks.
Sure. This is a continual source of stress and anxiety for many people, and a flippant answer to the question would be, How can I deal with the fact that the Freemasons have infiltrated the church? And you say, you could answer, well, so what else is new? You know, because you know, if you look at church teaching, the church forbade membership in the Freemasonic fraternity and the various forms of it. There's different forms of it throughout the world, between England, Scotland, the European continent, the United States, all that. But membership has always been forbidden to Catholics. All the way up until the present time, you can buy from the Vatican Press a book which goes over the history of prohibition of Catholics being in the Freemasonry, and clarifications on it published by Pope Benedict when he was head of the Holy Office. So all that stuff is available. It's official Catholic teaching, and it's true that a Catholic is forbidden to be a member of the Freemasonic fraternity, and that such membership precludes participation in the sacraments. That is, it's incompatible with the Catholic commitment to worshiping God according to the worship revealed by Jesus Christ in the Mass and in the worship of the Church. It's a separate liturgy, a separate set of practices and symbols that conflict with the sacraments. So that's the first reason why it's not permitted. The Church has always specifically forbidden clergy to be in the Freemasons. And that was from the 18th century until now. since the 1700s until the present. There's a prohibition on that. And, of course, there wouldn't be a prohibition if it wasn't occasionally a problem. But the way in which it's a problem is the issue that that sometimes gets people, you could say, to use California terminology, weirded out about it or super anxious. And that is that it's not directly necessarily related to any kind of deliberate conspiratorial intention. It's more related to human respect, to an excessive concern for the opinion of the well-off and the influential on the part of the clergy. That is, in countries where clerical membership in masonry is a problem, and that's usually Latin countries mostly, and also in Eastern Europe, priests or bishops might join because they think it's good for the church. That is, for me to associate with these major figures of business and politics and academia, that's something which can be helpful to the church. So the church is willing to work with these people. And so they deceive themselves into thinking that they should join because it will help the church. And so very often the reason why people have done this is not that they're conspiring to destroy the church, but because out of human weakness, vanity, human respect, or preferring their own prudence to the law of the church, they do this. And that's the way it began in the 18th century with the clerics, and that's the way it continues to this day. And I think that's what you'll find more than the creepy conspiracy element. And of course, it's not widespread. You do not have to explain the difficulties of modern culture entirely by individual machinations of the Masonic fraternity. It's part of the picture, but there's also a part of Freemasonry which is rather indifferent or not apparently particularly dangerous. But the fact is, for Catholics, it's always something which is prohibited. And for very many, for the Eastern Orthodox, at least the Russian observance is very strict against Freemasonry, and also certain forms of very Orthodox Protestantism, because they recognize its incompatibility with Christianity. But so, yes, it's a problem. Yes, there can be Freemasons in the church. Yes, their worldly outlook can be damaging to the church. But it's impossible, because it is a secret organization, to determine who and what they're about. And so any opinions about that, that's just something that someone can have an opinion, but there's never sufficient public evidence of it. And they're very important examples throughout history. But that should not be our focus. Our focus should be the reason why the church forbids membership is because the church wants us to be engaged fully and completely in the worship of Jesus Christ and the Holy Mass. So if you want to combat the Masonic conspiracy, if there is one, or Masonic membership, pray for those who have been misled into joining out of human respect. And then also love the Holy Mass and go to Mass and encourage people to assist intelligently and lovingly, and you'll be combating them in the best way anyone possibly could.
Okay, Ida.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Ida, God bless you.
Could you just clarify something real quick? This family member alleges that the Pope is a Freemason?
There's like the Vatican is filled with Masonic symbols.
Because Masonry came about in the 18th century. There are a lot of classical symbols from all kinds of sources that are just general symbols used in art and historically in the classical world. And so it doesn't automatically mean that they have Masonic significance.
No, that would be like saying that medieval Hindus were Nazis because they used the swastika.
Right. Well,
that predated the use of the swastika by the Nazis.
Although it is related to the Aryan origins of the European race. But but that's a different question. But yeah, there's a lot of that, you know, where there's a virgin mother and child thing among the gods of Egypt. And so Isis and Horus. And so therefore Catholic veneration of Mary is based on that. That kind of really, really extreme, stupid reasoning, and you get a lot of that.
That's what the internet is for, extreme stupid reasoning. That's why the internet was invented. Our number, Ida, thank you very, very much.
Except for Catholic Answers on the internet, of course.
Of course, where they're battling the, what was it, extreme stupid, I don't know.
All the media people are here, and they're being told that their whole world is just...
sorry, media
people. I did
it
too.
888-318-7884 is the number. Father Hugh Barber is our guest. It is Ask a Priest this hour, and it will continue to be Ask a Priest into the next hour because we're going to continue this. So there's one line open. You can get on that line, and we'll get your question to Father. But if you're already on the line, just hang on a quick minute. We're going to be right back to continue with Ask a Priest. And we'll ask Father, too, when we come back about the Focus episode. We got you on our podcast tomorrow. I keep thinking it's Monday, but it's Tuesday. So that means the podcast drops tomorrow. And you talk about the Mass in there. And you talk about the one thing the devil hates more than anything else. So I'll leave that as a tease. Mm-hmm. We'll get to that on the other side. Father Hugh Barber, our guest, will be right back with more Ask a Priest on Catholic Answers Live right after this. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Feels like a Monday, but it's a Tuesday because we had a holiday. It's a little poem I made up. Just came out. I don't know. Father Hugh Barber is our guest. 888-318-7884. What do you do in the monastery on like a secular holiday? Is there
secular holiday?
Like, well, you get a special snack.
Well, the lay people that might work at the monastery, they have the day off, generally speaking.
Yeah,
and then sometimes we have, like, for Memorial Day or 4th of July, we might have a cookout and some kind of ball game down on the field, you know, after Vespers, instead of having more formal dinner in the refectory. We do the American thing, you know, we have the game and a cookout. And it's that's what we do,
but
pretty much.
Not on Labor Day.
On Labor Day, usually we have, but this year we didn't. I don't know why I didn't ask.
Oh, yeah.
But we had a perfectly suitable dinner, so I was fine. I thought it was going to be hamburgers, because normally they do an American menu on those days. But
you got a ringer on the baseball team down there, Father Allen. He's a baseball player, right?
Yeah, he plays very well. Yeah, he's very good at it. Yeah.
888-318-7884. Father, I said in our tomorrow's podcast, where you are our guest, you said there's one thing the devil hates more than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And that was like my tease to make people come back. So can you tell
us? And it's not that I talk to him, but
you haven't actually asked the devil that.
But you need to listen to the podcast to find out.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's what we're going to do. We're just going to leave it hanging. Okay.
I'll leave it hanging. Leave it hanging.
All right.
Because the Mass is so powerful and marvelous that you need to get the whole picture, don't you think?
I think so. I think that's fair enough. I like it, Father.
You know it has to do with the Mass, so...
All right, let's go back to calls then, because every single line is full currently. It's Ask a Priest. Father Hugh Barber is our guest, and Judith in Syracuse, New York, is next, listening on EWTN. Judith, thanks for the call. Go ahead with the question for Father Hugh Barber.
Yes. Hello. Good evening, Father.
Hey.
I have a question on Revelation 22, paragraph 18 and 19. It confuses me because it says, I warn everyone who hears the prophetic words of this book, if anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues described in the book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the prophetic book, God will take away his share in the tree of life and in the holy city described in this book. And I can't help but think of the catechism. As much as I love it, I mean, I just love studying it, and it's such a wonderful explanation of things that I don't understand in the Bible. Could you please explain what this means?
Sure. Well, of course, that curse at the end is actually a curse. It refers to just to the book of Revelation, just to the Apocalypse. It doesn't refer to the entire Bible, because the Bible is not a single book. It's a collection of many books. And so it's referring to the book of Revelation precisely. And so what it's saying is that you are not authorized to add to this particular revelation, which is being offered in this particular book. And of course, in the Hebrew mentality with which the book is written, adding to the words, the word in the Hebrew tradition is a really strong expression. It means the facts, the innermost reality, the thing itself. Like, if you try to change the message, that's basically what it means, change the message. It's not like magic, like if you add to the incantation, that doesn't work, or it has the opposite effect. It's not like that. It's more that you're abusing or altering or corrupting the message. That's just like when St. Paul says, even if an angel from heaven should come and preach to another gospel than the one I preach to you, let him be anathema. So that there are curses in the Bible against people that misrepresent God's revelation. The Catechism, on the other hand, assists us in understanding the book of Revelation, because obviously that's a book of all the books in the Bible that cries out for someone to please explain this to me, because it's such a mysterious and difficult book. And so the idea there is that you can explain it in other words in order to explain the actual message of the book. And one needs to know the way it was written, the type of imagery, the way it depends upon Jewish and Hebrew and Jewish apocalyptic literature, the images used, what's taken from the Old Testament, from Ezekiel especially, and all of that, that is experiences of Ezekiel. And really make use of that to explain the book. That's not adding, that's just expounding. So the Catechism just explains something. It doesn't add to it. Just like a sermon on the scriptures is not adding to the scriptures, it's just explaining them.
Does that help you, Judith?
Yes, very much so. Can I ask another quick question?
Go right ahead. You're online.
Yeah.
You kind of put us on the spot. I can't really say no.
Go ahead.
I mean,
yeah, so good. ask.
Yeah, go ahead. That's fine.
Okay, thank you. In Jude 22 through 23, it says, which is another one of my favorite books, and those who waver have mercy, save others by snatching them out of the fire, and others have mercy with fear, abhorring even the outer garments stained by the flesh. Then you go back into Revelation at the end, and it says, then he said to me, do not seal up the prophetic words of this book, for the appointed time is near. Let the wicked still act wickedly, and the filthy still be filthy. The righteous must still do right, and the holy must still be holy. Well, okay, why are we doing that? If we were supposed to snatch people out of doing bad things.
Are these opposing to one another?
I see.
In Jude,
yeah. Save some by snatching out of the fire, as opposed to those who are wicked, let them remain wicked. Is that what you're talking about?
Right.
Yeah. Well, of course, the book of Revelation is talking more in terms of the actual state of affairs. Like, you know, you're doing the best you absolutely can, but it's reminding you also that in God's providence, he is going to permit certain people to persist in their wickedness. That's a great mystery. Of course, they do so freely. God has not forced them to be wicked, but in his providence we've seen, his permission, we see that he does allow certain people to be wicked and who are not going to respond to our attempts to save them. Whereas Jude just refers to the attempt to save them, which of course we should do. But maybe in John's apocalypse, which is so burdening anyway, it's such a grandiose and partly scary book and consoling book at the same time, he's just basically telling us, you know, you do the best you can to save people, but there are some people that are just not going to be saved. At least as far as we know, and that's what he presents. But Jude is saying, no, let's try to save people, and that's the basic message. But then he also says, on some have mercy with fear, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh, meaning when you have mercy on them, realize that you could still be corrupted by them because they're too dangerous, you know?
Yeah.
And so to keep that, don't get too cocky about showing mercy, because you also need to concern yourself for your own salvation. Does that help?
No. So much. Thank you very, very much. Yeah. Have a wonderful evening.
You too. Thanks. God bless.
All right. Thanks, Judith.
God bless. Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Let's go to Ann in Colorado, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Ann, so glad to have you. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Why must the rosary be said out loud? Often I say the rosary silently while waiting in the doctor's office or in line at the store. And what effect does it have on the rosary if said silently?
Maybe there's a little confusion there in the sense that traditionally it was held that in order to gain the indulgences attached to vocal prayers, that we have to say them. If we just do them mentally, we don't get the indulgence. But that isn't true anymore. So that's not held anymore. So in fact, although one is encouraged to say the rosary vocally, at least in this sense, moving your lips, you know, with the words, to kind of engage your whole body, you don't absolutely have to. You're perfectly free. When you're praying, you're talking to a Heavenly Father and you're talking to the Blessed Mother, and you could talk to them out loud. You can talk to them in a whisper. You could talk to them by your posture, by the way you move your lips. You can talk to them in your heart. But the rosary counts if you're reciting the Hail Marys even mentally. That it used to be that in order to gain the indulgence, you had to say the words vocally, but that is it's not the common opinion anymore. The priest, for example, prays the divine office, the Liturgy of the Hours, he's supposed to say the words at least labially, you know, using his lips when in private, but he doesn't have to say them out loud so that someone else can hear them. So you're free to do it anyway, but my recommendation is that when you pray the rosary, it's kind of good. It's almost natural that your lips kind of follow the words in your head as you're doing it, even though you may be meditating. But you don't absolutely have to, so you're okay.
Thank you very much.
Yep, you're
That's
very welcome.
A lot.
Sure.
Well, thank you
God
for
bless,
standing
peace.
In a grocery line praying the rosary.
Right, exactly. My goodness.
Well, you don't waste your time.
Well, yes, I do. You don't waste your time. God bless you, Anne. Thanks. We got to take a break. We'll be right back with more Ask a Priest with Father Hugh Barber.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage Program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
There was no single event. It was more gradual. You know, eventually you just don't go one Sunday and then you don't go two Sundays in a row. Then went through a divorce and ended up being a single parent. If I didn't have church or God, I would be back at that lonely stage, that trouble stage. Whenever you get anxious and worry about things, you just know that Jesus has it under control.
If you've been away from the Catholic Church for any reason, visit CatholicsComeHome.org.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Father Hugh Barber is our guest, which is always good news. If you've got a question for Father, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Bill in Tampa, Florida, watching on YouTube. You are up next. Bill, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question.
Thank you for taking my call, Father.
Good. Great, Bill.
Recently, I had a conversation with a non-denominational Protestant friend, and he was all about his personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So I pointed out how Jesus founded a church and instituted sacraments and the importance of community. But my question is, he made some good points. So what is the Catholic concept of a personal relationship or encounter with Jesus Christ?
Well, our concept is that he comes with his Father and their Holy Spirit in the life of grace that we receive through faith and baptism, through our conversion to him in our infancy, and then as we second that in later on consciously, he comes and dwells in our soul by grace. He actually enters into the very essence of our being, the essence of our soul. So that he's not just being experienced as an outside object, but he actually becomes the principle of a new form of life in us that we would not have by nature, that is the life of grace. And so that means that our soul is in contact with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit through Jesus taking on our humanity and giving the grace of God to us through his sacraments, which are like instruments of his human nature, conveying the divine grace to us, like as though he were using a paintbrush or a pen or something to affect results in our soul, so that it's a deep and inner reality that's an object of faith. You know, you can't see it, and you don't always experience it, but we know that it's there by our faith. That if you know, and our Lord says very clearly regarding the sacraments, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you shall not have life within you. And he says, the man who feeds on me will live because of me. And so those sacraments are not just external, institutional, clerical, hierarchical requirements for a relationship with Jesus, but rather they are the way in which Jesus enters us most intimately in our soul, but also through an outward bodily sign of his sacrament that gives us a participation in his body and his blood, and together with his body and blood, his own human soul interpenetrating ours, and his divinity enlightening us from within and giving us faith, hope, and love. So our relationship with Jesus has to do with his giving us his grace and dwelling in us so that he becomes the fulfillment of our understanding, of our power to choose, and then gradually he helps us with all our feelings and our memories and imagination. That is, he means to take over our entire inner life, to possess us interiorly so that we become entirely his. As St. Paul says, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me.
What do you think, Bill?
Would it be right to say then that all of our institutional activities are just, they add to that too? It all comes together in one beautiful relationship.
Right, because we're human beings, so we exist in a community. Religion is not just a personal thing, it's a community thing. That everything we get of any importance, marriage, the family, education, work, medical care, all kinds of things, we get in a community. And that requires institutions, that is, things that people get together that function as a group effort under some kind of authority or a set of rules or whatever. That's just a human reality. And God has never said that his relationship with souls is not institutional. He instituted the rites and the hierarchy of the people of Israel, and he instituted the worship and the hierarchy of his church after he died for our sins and then rose gloriously and from heaven directs his church, founded on his sacraments and his apostles. So institutions, you know, people say it as though that's somehow automatically proof that it's bogus.
Yeah.
You know, oh, it's an institution. Well, you like it or not, that's what human life involves. And yes, institutions can be corrupted and people can misbehave. That's why there's a church, because people are sinners and Jesus wants us to live right. So
thanks, Bill. I'm going to keep moving because so many folks on the line for okay. Father, but we're going to stay in Florida. Greg in Jacksonville, Florida, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Greg, go ahead with your question for Father.
Hello, Father.
Hey, Greg.
Hi. Today in my fourth grade religion class, catechesis.
You sound awfully old to be a fourth grader.
I know. Are they
just teasing you?
Do the other kids have deep voices like you?
I hope not. Not yet. but we were talking about the beatification process and the canonization process. And so one thing that I haven't gotten asked yet, but I know I will, because probably 50% of my students are not Catholic.
Uh-huh.
Why do we ask the saints to pray for us? Why? Because a Protestant friend of mine, family member, says, why do you ask dead people to pray for you? Why not just ask God directly?
Yeah.
So when I do get asked that question, I would love to be able to give a good answer.
Sure. And it's an easy answer to give. Because first of all, you can object. You can say, you describe people that died in the faith of Jesus Christ as dead? That's not the way the apostle would describe them. They are living in God, and their bodies are dead, yes, but they're going to rise from the dead. So first of all, they use the term dead saints to make it sound sick and pagan and weird, but it's not. All right, so that's number one. The saints are alive to God and living in him in Christ Jesus as they were on earth. Then secondly, God made everything, he made absolutely everything in the world, and nothing happens without the power that comes from God, the Creator. But he's ordered it that we get certain things only by asking other people or collaborating with them. I mean, you might as well say, why do you ask your mom for breakfast when God is giving you breakfast? Why do you ask someone for instruction when God is the truth? That we ask the saints to pray for us just the same way we ask our living friends on earth to pray for us. You know, my mother's sick, please pray for her. Well, that's you're asking other Christians, you're praying other Christians to pray for you. Because pray just means ask. And so why should there be an impenetrable wall between this world and the next for Christians who live in the Spirit? When someone goes to heaven, that person is in God's full presence, sees God face to face, and is totally free to pray for all of our intentions. And we understand the saints know, because they see everything in God, what we are asking for and who's asking, and they follow God's will in obtaining it for us. And that's the way God likes it. He shares his power with others. He's not jealous of his power. He wants us to do good and to be like him. And so as we pray to him for things and for everything, really, but he also is pleased when we ask him for things through the good souls that he has created. And that's a pleasing thing to God, honoring the saints. It shows that we recognize his gifts to them, and the same as when we ask anybody that we know that's living to pray for us. So it's the most reasonable thing of all that a Christian can do, and it gives honor to God.
Greg, I hope that was helpful to you, but I'd like to be even more helpful to you. We have a 20 Answers book on prayer I'd like to send you that was written by two very fine priests, one of them Father Sebastian Walsh.
Right.
Oh, the other one is Father Hugh Barber. Sorry. I forgot to mention that. I apologize.
It doesn't matter. He finished it. I began it. He finished it.
But hang on the line and we'll send that to you. Father, we have a division of labor between you and me. I say dumb things to the callers.
I should not.
No, see, you're the brilliant mind that answers the questions.
Okay, all right.
You don't say things like...
I shouldn't
like,
tease the callers.
You sound like you're not too, kind of old for fourth grade.
Oh, sorry. Forgive me. I'm corrected. Please.
It was good, Father. It was good. I wish I
would have done it. Don't hold that against me. I was just playing with you.
No, okay. But do hang on the line so we can send you 20 answers prayer, Greg. Going up to the Bay Area now, Anonymous, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Anonymous, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Hi, Father. I moved to the Bay Area for school from Southern California, and two people from home, both practicing Catholics, are wanting to visit and stay with me in my apartment for the weekend. One is the girl I'm dating, and the other one is a mutual friend of ours. I was wondering if there are any issues with this situation. Probably just be, you know, two or three nights. Maybe they'd come a couple times while I'm here. And would there be an issue, such as scandal, for example, if it was just the girl I'm dating staying with me alone? Even if we were in separate rooms?
Well, I would say, first of all, they is a very important qualification. If it's the two of them and you are both, you're all of agreement that you're supposed to be chaste, I think three, you know, is safer. So three is okay, for just a few days and whatnot. That would be all right. But the two of you alone, even if you know for sure that you're not going to be an approximate occasion of sin, it's so clearly most of the time approximate occasion that I would say you really shouldn't have her stay in your apartment, especially if you live alone. Do you live alone?
Okay. I do.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. I would say no, I wouldn't do that. Now, if in a case of extreme indigence, like there's no way that she could afford any other place to stay, you know, there are arguments you could evince for that. But I'm saying that the thing is there, it's just, and as far as scandal goes, that's the other thing is, that, you know, do you want to live in a society where an unmarried man can be spending the night with his girlfriend with no one else there, and that's, everyone's supposed to think, well, nothing's going on. Because in general, if that behavior occurred, you'd be certain that there would be a lot of fornication, you know. I'd be particularly reserved about that. But again, there are always mitigating circumstances, like extreme indigence, you know, or no other choice.
Yeah.
And also, if there's absolutely no scandal, that's one possibility. But, especially if it became anything like habitual or regular, because then it's just that, you know, we're not clever enough to combat the devil's wiles. I mean, he's going to be after us, and it's just human nature. I mean, the relationship of man and woman is always directed towards union, you know, and that's the way it is. So you want to protect yourself there. And but I would say, if there's another friend, is the other friend a girl also?
The other friend's a guy.
No. Oh, okay. Well, that's fine. But then you and the guy can stay one place and she can stay in a room entirely by herself. That would be all right, yeah. I would say. There's some people that say that wouldn't be okay either, but assuming your goodwill, which is evident because you're calling, and you have another friend there as the chaperone who is principled enough to say, hey, then, you know, it probably is okay. But I would, I say that with no enthusiasm. Just
okay.
Okay.
Okay, Anonymous?
Sure. God bless.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Peace.
Thank you. I think he's a billionaire. He lives in the Bay Area by himself in a two-bedroom apartment. You have to be a billionaire to afford that in the Bay Area.
So he could get her a hotel room.
I think so, because I think he's worth literally $1 billion.
Well, he might be cheap, too. Well, you never know.
You're really a smart aleck today. I love it.
Oh, we're online. I'm so sorry.
I absolutely love it. 888
Excuse me, I didn't mean that, Anonymous. I really didn't.
No, we're just playing.
We're just playing around.
Of course he knows that. He's not a billionaire. Right. Tim,
no, he just loves her, that's all.
Omaha, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. You're next, Tim. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome. Go ahead.
Yeah. Father, I'd like to ask a question about plenary indulgences. The first, there's maybe two questions, but they're short. But the first one is, does a plenary indulgence absolve you from past sins that you may have forgotten, both mortal, venial, original, any sins that you have by participating in doing a plenary indulgence?
And then the second question?
And then the second question is, examples, you have to, you think I know there's three parts to the plenary indulgence. Is that true?
I can explain that after the break.
We got to take a quick break here, Tim. Just hang on and we'll get an answer to both of those questions from our guest, Father Hugh Barber. Right,
hang on. Thanks.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. It's free, and you'll have instant access to our daily broadcast, the schedule of upcoming shows, and you'll even be able to search the archive and listen to thousands of past shows. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Most of us Catholic parents agree our number one goal in life is to pass on the faith to our children. But here's the bad news. Today's world has a million ways to steal your kid's soul. Don't be afraid, says Father Sebastian Walsh. God loves your children even more than you do, and he desires their salvation more than anything. In his groundbreaking new book, Always a Catholic, Father Walsh shows you how to cooperate with God to bring about the fulfillment of his will for your kids. Always a Catholic reminds us that keeping our kids in the faith is about the way we live our Catholicism in our own lives and as a family from day to day. Order your copy of Always a Catholic by visiting shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Johnette Williams. We embrace the essence of feminine spirituality on Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. And our guest is Father Hugh Barber, and it's Ask a Priest today on Catholic Answers Live. On the line is Tim in Omaha, Nebraska, with two questions. First of all, can a plenary indulgence, and I believe he used the word absolve, but past sins that you may have forgotten, whether mortal or venial? And the second part was about what are the three kind of aspects of receiving a plenary indulgence?
Well, first of all, an indulgence is actually not precisely the remission of sin, or absolution from sin. An indulgence is the remission of the temporal punishment due to sin. That is, that it has to do with the purification to be undergone after death in order to be able to be purified in order to enter heaven. And so, and that's because the Church can draw on the superabundant merits of our Lord, our Lady, and the saints, and they can share the satisfactory value. They more than made up for anybody's sins and whatnot, and so they can share the satisfactory value of their good works through the intervention of the Church, because the good works are performed in charity, and anything that's a result of charity or of love can be shared. Love by its nature is a sharing thing. So it means that the intensity of love, which gave value to the works of our Lord, our Lady, and the saints, can be shared with you so that it can make up for your lack of love in the sins that you committed so that you can more quickly enter heaven. That's really theologically what it's all about. And so plenary indulgence means that the action performed that has a plenary indulgence attached to it is of itself, through the church's intervention, if performed uprightly and with fulfilling the conditions, is of itself sufficient to cancel the whole debt of temporal punishment that a person may have for oneself or for one of the souls in purgatory. It's either way. You can apply it for the souls of the departed, or you can apply it to yourself. So that's what it is first. So it's not really the remission of the sin. It's the remission of the punishment due to sin. And of course, we know that if we had absolutely perfect love of God and neighbor, the whole punishment due to sin would be remitted. It's all a question of love. So the first thing is to pray for a greater and more fervent love of God and neighbor, and then that will give us the best dispositions to cancel out the debt of our sins. And if we gain plenary indulgence in that disposition, we will really and truly get what we hope to obtain. Now, for a plenary indulgence, we have to perform the act indicated. For example, half an hour meditation on sacred scripture, that's one of them, or praying the rosary in church in front of the Blessed Sacrament, or in company with other people, or making the Stations of the Cross. There are various things that can be done. They're all in the church's list of indulgences, which you can find on the Vatican website. You can find that, the list of indulgences that lists all those things. In this year of St. Joseph, any of the traditional prayers of St. Joseph, like the Litany of St. Joseph, have a plenary indulgence attached to them also. Normally it's just partial. So you have to perform the act indicated, and you have to do so for the plenary indulgence without any attachment to sin, even venial. Now that means that you are not currently willing to continue in any particular sinful habit that you're aware of. That is, you have to have enough sorrow for all your sins that you could confess them fruitfully. So it means that, you know, if there's some little sin that you're really not interested in correcting, then you can't get the plenary indulgence. You might get a lesser partial indulgence, but you can't get the plenary indulgence because that requires a complete detachment from sin. It doesn't mean that you don't have any sinful habits. It means that you are actively striving against them. But in any case, so that's that. So the work performed, freedom from any attachment to sin, even venial, and then Holy Communion, one Holy Communion per plenary indulgence, and then confession within 3 weeks, basically 20 days, they say, before or after the plenary indulgence work that you're performing. And that the one confession can suffice for a plenary indulgence every day. So you have a communion, which is on the day you gain the indulgence or associated with it soon enough, and then confession within 20 days before or after, and that detachment from sin. And you also apply the indulgence to yourself or to the souls in purgatory. So those are things you can do. Now, I recommend to people that they gain their indulgences, or all of them, or as many as possible, for the souls in purgatory, because I kind of feel like God will be more generous in granting that because I'm doing it for somebody else than just for myself. But that's up to you in any case.
Okay. Okay, Tim?
Okay. Yeah. Great. Yeah. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Sure. Thank you. God bless you.
Ask a Priest today. Catholic Answers Live. Our friend Father Hugh Barber here to answer your questions. We go now to Kansas City. Andrew, watching us on Twitch. More and more people finding Catholic Answers on Twitch, which is a gaming thing, right? Yeah. Well, that's cool. Hi, Andrew.
Hey, how's
Hello.
It going?
Hey.
Cool. Hey, thanks for taking my call. Sure. I'm a Protestant student who's going through a conversion and looking to join RCIA this upcoming year.
Praise God.
It's been fantastic. I'm going through, it's a private Catholic university. Inside the program, there's a topic we're talking about this week that I wanted some context from you guys who are obviously masters of the topics we're going through.
So we love it, Andrew, when people call and ask Father to do their homework for them. That is the best. So,
well, hopefully I've done a little bit of homework.
Oh, yeah, of course you have.
To get your guys' perspective on it.
All right, go ahead. Give it to us.
This week we're talking about basically the perspective of God, or how people view or interact with God on a practical basis. One belief that our professor has talked a lot about is the idea of panentheism. Basically, he's explaining it as the view that God is not only in everything surrounding us, but also something that we're able to experience, whether it's through nature, beauty, and even further past that, basically, that God is part of those things. I've tried to do some research. I've gone through some kind of Vatican I documents, basically just trying to see what the Catholic view is on that, if it's separated too far from the traditional view of God the Father, or if that's just kind of a postmodern separation, kind of a God's the river that we see kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it's the understanding we have of God's penetration or omnipresence in the universe is very profound, and in the sense that God there's a very true sense in which God contains the universe. The universe doesn't contain God. You know, that is to say that God is in the world, but actually the world exists in Him. But when we say in Him, we don't mean that the world is of the same nature as God, or that the world is part of God, or that He makes the world out of Himself. We believe that we're theists, you know, in the sense that we believe that there's a God who is infinitely beyond this world and transcends it completely, and yet on whom this world depends because He creates it out of nothing. But the nothing He creates it out of means precisely He creates it absolutely. He gives it being radically. That is, He doesn't make it out of something pre-existing, like some of the ancient cosmogonies, and He doesn't make it out of any part of Himself either, like some classic pagan views, like of the Stoics and so on. So God, in order for God to create the world, it means that the world is radically dependent on Him, so that He is present in all things by His essence, because He alone can give anything actual existence. And so He's present everywhere by His essence and His power, because otherwise these things would not exist at all. So He's continually creating, in the sense that although for Him creation is an instantaneous event, and that creatures depend upon Him and they work out their existence over time, but in Him it's a single event that depends on His ability to draw things, an infinite ability to draw something into being which absolutely did not exist before, and is not made of anything pre-existing, and isn't just an extension of Him. And if you understand creation in that sense, it's correct to say that God contains the world, that He's omnipresent, He's in it, He's in the depths of each and everything, and that yes, nature and our use of our reason and all these things indicate His existence, because we prove His existence because we prove that the world has to depend utterly and absolutely on Him. And in order for us to be able to see that, we have to come to the realization that if the world didn't depend on Him actively, then it wouldn't exist. And so coming to know that God exists from our point of view means, in fact, realizing that He's present in all things by His creative power, but not as a part of Him, but rather as the effect of His transcendent, infinite power, which is more intimate than just simply sharing a part of Himself with us, because it's actually giving us our very quote-unquote autonomous being. We're beings and He's a being, but our being depends completely on His. Does that help?
Yeah, that helps a lot. We were just talking about St. Thomas Aquinas and, you know, contingency and the proofs of God. So that would be a great tie-in for the paper.
Right. Well, that's wonderful. And, of course, and I'm glad that you're getting such a fine presentation of the faith, that they're actually considering these issues that are so consoling and invigorating. When we finally realize what it means to be created, it's quite astounding, because, you know, Andrew, will only see what it means to be created out of nothing when, after this life and your perseverance, you see God face to face. And then you'll see yourself coming out of God out of nothing. You know, that's I look forward to that. It's one thing is to see God, but then to see yourself as you actually are. You know, that how you actually are coming out of all that's going to be quite an experience. So we can look forward to that together, okay?
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you guys' time.
Yeah. God bless.
Thank you.
Peace.
It was great talking with you, Andrew, and you encourage us. I'm so happy that you're in an RCIA program. Just so people know, if you're listening, for many Catholics around the world, now would be not. It's not the same everywhere. It's not the same in every parish. But now would be the time that people are starting in their preparations to come into the church at Easter time. So in those places where people prepare and then come in at Easter, often September, August time is when it'll start in the parish, and that's called the Rite of Christian Initiation for adults, and that's what Andrew is doing. And if that's something that you're interested in, you can just Google the RCIA, or you just visit your local parish and ask them about. It's not a thing, but it's not a commitment. You don't, when you take the RCIA classes, you have not yet committed. It's an inquiry. And if you'd like to make that inquiry, just visit your parish and ask about when they're doing it. Now would be a good time to start. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more. Father Hugh Barber, Ask a Priest on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, this is Archbishop Alexander Sample of the Archdiocese of Portland in Oregon. Keep that dial right here on Catholic Answers Live.
St. John Paul II stated that, for the disciple of Christ, evangelization is a duty, an obligation of love. And the Catechism of the Catholic Church states that evangelization is necessary for salvation.
So we know we're called, but how do we do it?
St. Paul Street Evangelization can help. To learn more, contact us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
Our mission is to transform the world one woman at a time through a spiritual program of formation that helps them to see who they are as daughters of the Most High God and to enjoy the gift that God has given to them by virtue of their femininity.
Women of Grace with Jeanette Bankovic Williams. Tomorrow morning, 11 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. I'm on a great Tuesday afternoon here in Southern California with Father Hugh Barber, who is a Norbertine priest, and here to help you. If you've got a question for a priest, just give us a call, because we'll probably have time to get one or more on than we currently have on, because there's just a couple folks on. I haven't given out the number because there's been so many on the line, but here's the number, 888-318-7884. We're going to Lucky in Albuquerque, Texas, watching on YouTube. Albuquerque, Texas, I did not know. I thought, I know Albuquerque in New Mexico, but I didn't know there was a Albuquerque, Texas. Lucky, you there with us?
Hi, Cy. Hey. Yeah, actually, I'm in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And I was speaking on my speakerphone. That's probably what the confusion was.
Oh, this forget it then. We just call another day. I cannot deal with this. Unprofessional. Go ahead, Lucky. Go ahead with your question.
Hey, first I just wanted to say, Cy, it's great to speak to you and Father Hugh. Just great. Honored to speak with both of you.
Oh, thank you.
My question is, thank you. My question is, I attend Mass daily and very much practice my Catholic faith. But I also like to fellowship with my Protestant brothers and sisters, and I regularly will attend a worship at their church on a Sunday, and I never partake in their communion. And I'm regularly bouncing things back and forth with them about my Catholic faith, and actually been able to challenge them in a lot of different places on some things and change a few minds. But my question in general is it okay for me to attend a Protestant worship outside of partaking in their communion regularly would be an important word, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very good. Well, ordinarily, one would say that you can attend a Protestant service for a legitimate reason, one of which can be a desire to be better informed. If you're completely ignorant of Protestantism, and you might, as an adult, you might want to find out what it's all about and visit so you understand your neighbors better. So desire to be great, better informed is one reason. There's also the social obligations, of association with people. They invite you out of friendship. Or a family obligation, say you belong to a family which is entirely Protestant and you go to church with them occasionally. That's my case. When I visit my family on my home visit, I go to church with my Protestant relatives just as a, you know, to join them. But what you mentioned, regularly, just on your own, normally we wouldn't recommend that people do that because of the danger to their maintaining their Catholic faith. But what you describe, it doesn't sound like you're in any way tempted or moved to abandon your Catholic faith for Protestantism. And if that's true, it's a discernment that you need to make yourself, especially if, as you're saying, you're actually promoting the proper understanding of the Catholic faith among those people. And I would say maybe it's a challenge that you might suggest to one or another that they might be interested in looking into the claims of the Catholic Church or even becoming a Catholic. But you have to have an evangelical attitude, that is, that you're there to witness to the truth. And since we as Catholics have the full truth offered by our Lord, we should be eager to bestow it on them. And you might start with that, why is it that the one thing you absolutely should not do is receive their communion? And that might lead you to the rationale of why it's so advantageous for them to be in communion with the Catholic Church, so they can receive the Eucharist as our Lord instituted it. But I would say what you're describing, normally one would not recommend regular attendance, but only occasional because of social obligations or desire for information. But in your case, as I say, the way you describe it, it might be okay, but I'd be very careful that you're not being swayed to dissent from something the Church actually teaches, or begin to question it or doubt it, and that also you are within due reason, because it is their context, it's their house, you might say, promoting a right understanding of the Catholic faith, or even maybe encouraging someone to consider union with the Catholic Church. Does that make sense?
Amen. Yes, that makes perfect sense. I've actually just taken the kind of evangelical kind of position when I do go. And so I always kind of prepare my heart and pray before I go. And I'm just among some good friends over there. And I kind of liken their service to more of like a rock show, you know, not to insult their worship or anything else. But I do like to sing with them a little bit and praise the Lord,
if that
makes sense.
Well, I always enjoy the hymns, that's for sure. Yeah.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I love hymns, too. I've actually been to a Baptist church and like those kind of hymns and stuff like that, too, old-timey hymns. But
right. This
one's kind of more contemporary a little bit. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't have, you know, sometimes they partake in a communion, but it's nothing like the Mass, you know, understandably. And I always try and prepare my heart to be in a place where I'm not, you know, swayed as much as I, you know, just have a good conversation with them about it. And as I said, I've kind of compelled a couple of brothers and sisters and, you know, at least put the question in their mind.
Okay. Yeah, and it's not the Church's public worship, and they don't pretend that it is. I mean, the non-liturgical Protestants, in that sense, are a little safer than the liturgical ones, because it doesn't even appear to be what the Catholic Church does in her worship. So that's another point you can make there. Yeah.
Lucky, I'm going to let you go because we've got a whole bunch of folks on the line, but thank you very, very much for that call. Appreciate it, and prayers for you as you continue to call folks to the fullness of the Christian faith. I was about to give out the number, but I won't. It's getting late. Let's go to Meg in Georgia watching on YouTube. Meg, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Hi.
Hello.
There are many examples in the gospel about Jesus doing miraculous healing. Why did Jesus often tell the recipient not to tell anyone about the healing, and why did they so often disobey?
Well, it's a very interesting set of conditions there in the gospels. Our Lord understood very well that the revelation of his identity and his power was something which had to happen in due time. And it was mostly focused towards the fulfillment of his mission in the triumph of the resurrection, and a complete triumph over sin and death after having undergone death. And but the evil one, the demons, the evil one shows himself as trying to get the word out before its time to stir up trouble or difficulty or claims against our Lord. And there's a point at which the Lord even tells the demons to be quiet, you know, because they say, why have you come to torment us, Son of God? And he tells them to be quiet because he knows that when the devil says something that's true, he's not saying it for any good purpose. He's saying it either because he's being required by God or because he's trying to stir up trouble in a particular situation where it's not yet prudent. Now, also, our Lord gives an example to people who possess charisms in the future. The charism of healing is given to many people in the history of the Christian church, but charisms are not in and of themselves proofs of holiness. They're gifts of God given for the good of others. And so he also gives an example of that when you have this gift, you're not to use it in order that you might be glorified or that people might know about you and your healing power, but rather because you're an instrument of God's grace or help for somebody else. And so you see the saints, too, were never eager that the miracles they performed should be published abroad. And in fact, they always tried to ascribe them always to the intercession of some saint or the power of God, and they pushed attention away from themselves and even found the gifts of burden because it drew attention to them. And so our Lord, in his great humility, and, you know, someone who in person was giving up all the honor that was due to him as God in order to become a human being, to take on human nature, was a person that was personally totally indisposed to be made much of. Our Lord is extremely humble, and even with his great gifts, he was not interested that they be recognized because he depended on his Heavenly Father for the praise that he received, and he was not interested in increasing his popularity by his deeds. They did, but that's, so our Lord had that in mind. And then, of course, the people that disobeyed him, they weren't exactly sinning. I think they were just so enthusiastic that they couldn't help themselves and grateful, but there you are. So our Lord is humble, and also he does battle with the devil who tries to get the information out when it doesn't need to come out. So those are the two reasons.
What do you think, Meg?
I think that's great, and I'm going to the conference, so I'll look forward to seeing you there.
Great. Say hello to us. Great. Thanks, Meg. Thanks very much.
Okay.
Peace.
All right, we got one more call. I'm going to go quick to try to get Harry in Salem, Massachusetts. Enjoyed our conversation the other day. Harry, I'm glad you're back, but you got to be quick, real quick with this question, because Father doesn't have very much time.
All righty.
Okay.
Go ahead, Harry.
I went to a priest to go to confession. I showed up 15 minutes early to have my confession heard before the Mass, as I normally do. But this priest says, I can't see it today, Harry, at this time. He says, you can see me after the Mass, but he says, I won't be able to go to communion today then, because I got more to sin on me. So he goes, you can still receive communion now, and I'll hear your confession after.
Well, yeah, that I can understand why the priest said that, but it's not exactly correct. That is, if you were in danger of death or going into battle or something like that, and the priest could say, well, make that good act of contrition, and I can give you communion because there's not time to hear the confession or something like that. There are circumstances where that might be possible. But in this case, you were not bound to receive communion, and we barely ever are required or bound to receive Holy Communion. So, first of all, it wasn't an obligation on your part. You could always go the next day, and you could make a spiritual communion at the Mass and go to confession and then make a proper communion. And so I would not have said what that priest said. I would say, well, you know, just make a spiritual communion today, make an act of contrition, make a spiritual communion, tell our Lord that you love him and you want to receive him, but you can't this day, and I'll hear your confession after Mass, and so tomorrow you can go to communion. Or he could have, if he had more time, he could say, I'll hear your confession after Mass, and I'll give you communion after Mass, after the confession.
Oh, yeah.
Those priests are not always disposed to do that because they have all kinds of other duties, but that's also another possibility. But you're right, it was not exactly the right thing to say, although I can see why he said it.
Okay.
So that's it. But another lesson, try to go with due warning so that it's not just right before Mass. It's hard sometimes.
Okay, Harry?
Father, my whole life, and I'm 70 years old.
Yeah. Well, God bless you. Yeah. Yeah, but...
Do you think it... So if it was against God and I did the wrong thing because he directed
no,
me...
No. If you did what the priest said,
against me?
You were in good conscience, so don't worry. That wasn't a sin. You did what the priest said to do, and that's right. What you thought was right. So don't worry about that. But just in the future, you know, just get to confession. Jesus will take care of you.
Thanks, Harry. And tomorrow we have a new episode with Father on this very topic about making a spiritual communion and about Mass. Well, it's got several aspects, so anybody that wants to check that out can tomorrow on Focus. Father, can we have your blessing before we go?
Certainly.
Benedictio Dei Omnipotentis, Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descendat super vos et maniat semper.
Amen. Thank you so much, Father. Thanks, everybody in the booth. Mary, you did a great job on the video. Come on, that video was perfect. The whole show. Thanks, Zach. Thanks, Thomas. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.